Welcome to Nobody Told Me That, your source for candid business talk and stories. Your host is speaker and author Teresa Duncan. Sit back, buckle up, and hang on.
Welcome back to another episode of Nobody Told Me That. I have, you know, Kevin's going to get really mad. I have another man on my podcast. I'm actually a little bit excited about this. I have Dr. Paul Etchison with me. Hey, Paul, how are you?
Hey, thanks for having me. Glad to be here.
Absolutely. Yeah. No, Paul is, Dr. Etchison, I will call him Paul, but Dr. Etchison is an author and a dentist and a long time, I mean, like ancient, long time ago client when you were starting out. I can't even take any credit for anything you've done really, because it was so long ago and you've done so much. I have a lot to talk about with your book, because your book is phenomenal. And, you know, a lot of, absolutely. And I know a lot of my friends love reading dental books. I had no idea like that was such a niche, but it's really getting to be. So the name of your book is what, doctor?
It's Dental Practice Hero, From Ordinary Practice to Extraordinary Experience.
So I love it because your doctor in the picture has loafers on. And a mask. And I'm like, this is like the most casual dentist I've ever seen. So it's really funny. It is available on Amazon, and I will absolutely leave the notes, or in the notes, I'll leave a link. We're not going to talk completely about his book, because although there's a ton of good stuff in there, I really just like getting to who the people are in our industry. And one of the first things I wanted to ask you was, when you wrote this book, what exactly were you trying to accomplish? Like, was there, did you see a need, or were you just like, you know what, I rock and rolled this and I want to share it? Like, what was going through your mind?
Yeah, you know, it was kind of, I rock and rolled this and I wanted to share it. You know, it was one of those, just one of those kind of bucket list goals that I had. I always wanted to do it, and I always felt like I had a lot to offer. And the more I went to different CE and I talked to people at my practice, and I was a total CE junkie going to all these practice management things as well as clinical CE, I just wanted to take everything that I did at my practice that made it successful and kind of just lay it all out there. I've always kind of wanted to get into like the speaking realm and the key opinion leader realm. And I think it was just a good like foundational starting point for me to organize all my ideas. And it's weird. It's like we do all these things with the practice and it's successful, and we do it for reasons that we heard it from someone else, or we came up with it ourselves, or we came up with a system with our team. But then when you really sit down and try to put pen to paper, sometimes it's like, wow, I when I write it out, it just sounds different. I didn't realize that that's what we did, but that's what we do. So a lot of it just came natural. We just came up with it on our own. A lot was, I mean, they're all other people's ideas. I can't take credit for everything in there because, I mean, it's, you know how it is. We're all learning from each other.
Yes, absolutely. One thing that was really interesting, and I know a lot of consultants teach this, but the way you wrote it was like, okay, I get it now. You really have to write out step by step everything you do. Like in your setting, when the hygienist goes in the room, he or she has a couple steps to go through. It's not just walk in the room, seat the patient. Like there's actually like, it's that whole, have you ever done the peanut butter and jelly thing? Do you know what I'm talking about? So this was this big, please don't do this. If you're a speaker, please don't do this, because it's just so bizarre. So they tell you to write down the instructions for a peanut butter and jelly sandwich, and you should be able to follow the directions to do it, you know, the way it's written. And then when you write out the directions, you realize nobody knows how to make this. So you're supposed to open up the peanut butter jar. You're supposed to take a knife out of the drawer. Do you see what I mean? Like every little step. And I'm just like, put the peanut butter and the jelly on the bread. So if you did it my way, you would just be taking the jars and holding them upside down and just dumping peanut butter on a big loaf of bread. So details matter. So you even said the hygienist comes in, the hygienist does something with the monitor, does something with the treatment plan while you're doing something else. And when did you figure out that you needed to get that specific with your team?
You know, it was just something that I always wanted to do. I was an advertising major, so I saw a lot of the effects of what we put out there, what we present, and how that's interpreted. And much like how a brand, your brand is interpreted, it only matters in the mind of the consumer. So what we put out there is creating an expectation and a perception of us. So we just want to be really intentional about what we did. And we sat down with my hygienist and the other providers, and we just went through everything and said, hey, like, what can we do to make this the best? And then we just started building on it. And over years and years, we went back a little. I mean, we went through this, what I call a movement sequence, which is essentially, it's the script for our new patient. And I'll explain this just a little bit more in just a moment. But we went through this and retouched on this about four times now in our 7.5 year practice right now. What it is that you mentioned the monitor. So before they see the patient, I want there's a doctor chair and there's some rooms have an assistant chair. They're in certain positions in the room because the last thing I want to do is the patient to have to walk around it. The patient have to move it. The last thing I want to do when I come in is have to grab the chair and roll it back in front of the patient. So that should be ready so that it just seems flawless. Mm. We have monitors, like televisions in the corner of the operatories. And if I was looking at the patient, talking to the patient, it would be right behind my head. So what we found is that we shut that off. We switched that to a computer input that just shows like a logo of our practice, because even if we muted it and the picture was still going behind me, it's distracting. So it's all these little elements that we really kind of focus on that when people come through, they go, oh, wow, that was a really it was a nice experience. But they don't realize all the little things that we've planned and all these things that just behind the scenes things that are happening that's making it a great patient experience.
So having HGTV on the TV is distracting to the patient. So Do you what if like somebody's in the middle of like a law and order case and they're ready to solve the crime? Like, what do you do?
I mean, we've had it where like Maury Povich is on and they're reading the paternity results and they're like, hold on.
I'm just thinking, wow, I would be the worst patient because I would be like, hold off on the root canal. I need to know like who killed the husband, you know, with the butcher knife in the study. Like, I need to know that stuff. So
that hasn't come up yet. I haven't had anyone stop me or quite yet.
So put a note up front. Don't schedule that Teresa Duncan. She's going to be a problem.
we'll just make you watch like SpongeBob or something like that.
Oh my gosh. My son is 18 and I swear he still loves to watch SpongeBob, and I never really understood it, but now it's kind of funny now. And now we're bonding over something that he's getting ready to leave. And now we're bonding. Isn't that always the way?
Oh my gosh. Before I went to dental school, between undergraduate and dental school, I worked at a Radio Shack for a year, and that's all we watched in the store, and we loved it.
Well, now that's a blast from the past, the Radio Shacks. Are they still around? Are they still around?
I don't think so. Not by me.
Wow. That was the place to go if you needed like another speaker plug or, you know, the needle on the, my parents had the old radio, record players that were like a console, like big. Did your parents have those?
Yes.
And when we ran down the needle, I was the one who had to go with my dad, and he had a specific needle he needed. And oh my goodness. So you just brought up some blast for the past. And some people are like, what is a Radio Shack? Did they have a house of radios? What is a Radio Shack? Don't worry about it, young people. Don't worry about it.
Yeah, you don't need to know. It's all old stuff nobody wants anymore.
I'm sure there's some market, but it's not for us. So, so your team, when I appeared on your podcast, which of course I'll include a link to that. When I was on your podcast, we talked a lot about training the team and getting the team to observe your procedures and all of that. And you were saying that you were going to do that at your next couple meetings. How did that go? Did you do it? Or are you still planning to do it?
So here's what happened. I do plan on doing it. I had my associate had a baby and went on maternity, and I was doing 2 days a week clinical, 3 weeks a month. And then for the past like 2 months, she just came back.
Nice.
And I was doing 4 or 5 days clinical a week. So I didn't do much of anything.
Because you were down at like 3 days a week, right? 3 or 4 days a week?
Yeah, well, two. I was down to two. Wow. I was going into the office 3, but I was seeing patients only for 2 days a week. And I'm getting back on it. I'm wrapping up another project. And then, that's one of the things I want to do at the practice, but I haven't done, you know how it is. You know, we have all these like big plans and these things, and it's just not enough time in the day to get it all done.
Yeah. It's important that we try to slow down and enjoy life. But when you have somebody that you're covering for, forget it. It all goes out the window. Same thing for my office manager peeps that are always listening. You know how it is. You plan on going in and handling all the reports, and then your assistant calls in sick, or your hygienist, does something weird. And, cause hygienists do weird things. And I say that with love. Because I have a lot of hygiene friends, but y'all know you do weird things. So.
Yeah.
So it is nice to be able to have long-term staff, though. And that's something that you brought up in the book. How long term is your staff? Or I mean, is how are, what's going on over there? What are you putting in the water to keep people?
Yeah, so we're 7.5 years in, and we still have everyone except for one girl had left because she went to nursing school and became a nurse. So I mean, she's still a patient. We still have everybody. So I mean, for me, what that's been is it's relationship. I think a big part of it is that the relationship I have with the girls that work for me, it's not just a transactional thing where they do things for me and I pay them. I mean, we have a relationship. I know what's going on in their lives. That's been more of a challenge as we've grown to 26 people now. It's hard to keep up on everybody, especially when it's been a challenge. You know, I really tried to have to make effort to like keep up on and see what people are doing. But I think a lot of it's relationship. I think a lot of it's communication. I'm always asking them, how are things? What's going on? You know, what can we work on? I openly ask for criticism from them. And I make them give it to me. So a lot of times, no, you're great. You know, I'm like, no, what can I work on? No, you're perfect. I'm like, well, you're not leaving this office until you give me something. And every now and then they give me something just really like benign. And I'm like, come on, give me something good. But I think it's great to ask. I think it's really important for people to ask the people that work for them, like, what can I do? Like, give me some feedback. How am I doing as a leader? And then just always often, like, you have to be really careful about how you respond when you receive that criticism, because if you respond really poorly, you're not going to ever get it again. So I just saw an example that I had. I always have this open door policy, you know, where I want people to talk to me. And I always felt like people are very comfortable telling me anything because I'm always very careful about how I respond because I want to know this information. I want them to be able to come to me. And I want them to be comfortable even like telling me something like, you know what, I'm just not liking my job anymore or something like that. And these past 2 months, we did a survey. We do anonymous surveys. And someone had mentioned, I know you say you have an open door policy, but whenever I bring you something, you act like you're too busy to deal with it. Oof. And so I've had to kind of have to do a little reality check saying, okay, you know what? I mean, that probably did happen because I mean, I was doing all these clinical days and I'm trying to do all the stuff that I was doing before. And I could be like working on trying to get clear my desk. And then someone comes and says to me something about, hey, what do you think we should post on Facebook? Or I don't know. You know, I'm just like, I don't know. I don't give a crap right now. Like I'm doing this, you know? So I'm sure that's kind of how the conversation was, but I have no idea who posted that because we all do it anonymously. But it's just, you know, you always have to just check on that because it's how you respond will determine how much information you'll get from people in the future. And I want that honesty. I want that open, just open dialogue if anything's going on or if they want me to know something. It's helpful that they feel comfortable telling me.
You know, what a stressful drive home for you though, because you hear the feedback and you're probably not concerned so much with who was it, but you're probably running back all these days in your mind. Like, when did I do that? Did that happen?
Yeah, you know, I've kind of learned just to almost just brush that off. I feel like I've learned that over the years and just kind of like take it, you know, give it mental energy, give it the mental energy it deserves, and then just put it past and just go forward. You know, just saying, okay, I gotta worry about that, or I gotta be more cognizant of that, and let's just move on. Because I used to tell my wife, like, it'd be so nice to get home and get away from the practice where nobody can hurt me here. You know, because like every time I go to practice, I'm just like, I just feel like I get emotionally abused while I'm there, and I don't, but it's like the schedule's too booked, or you know, there's some drama. You know, we have a great team and we have great systems, but we're just like every other practice. Things go wrong and things happen. And, you know, it used to be like, I used to get so stressed out about it and I come home and just be like, oh gosh, like, now they can't hurt me when I'm here, and just shut my phone off. And you're part of running a business, you know, that's what you do. That's part of the game.
My dad is so funny. My dad's always like, you know, I was an only child, but apparently I was a force of nature. And so he was like, I would go to did you ever wonder why I was in the bathroom all the time? And I was like, yeah, I just figured, you know, that you're doing dad stuff. And he's like, no, I was hanging out. That was my peace, you know, away from mom and dad or mom and me. And I think that's how, you know, we have to handle that. Like I always joke in my classes that when we used to do film x-rays, like I would be the one that volunteered and went into the dark room because it was cold, it was nice, and nobody could come in because it, you know, it would ruin the film. So now you're fairly young. Do you remember even operating in that environment, or was it all digital?
I did it at my associateship, and we did it in dental school as well. So that's not, I mean, I'm 10 years out, but I don't think they do that in the dental school anymore.
Okay, got it. Now, and so let's dig in a little bit with your staff, if you don't mind, because I have a lot of questions, and a lot of times doctors will tell you what you want to hear, and I don't get that from you. So let's talk a little bit about the what's going on in the industry. So there's a lot of back and forth with, okay, the younger people don't want to work, the older people don't want to work, like nobody wants to work. It's hard to find good applicants, but here you are with a very strong long-term team. What's going on out there is it's really hard to find talent. Do you feel that, or are you hearing that from your colleagues? You're probably hearing it more than you're feeling it.
Well, I know I would agree with that. And I would say for hygienists, we have never, ever struggled finding talented people. That is the position where we've hired for most often, where we've had to like choose between people often.
Nice.
So I haven't had that for hygienists, but for front desk people and assistants, it has been such a struggle. And I don't know what it is, if God's looking out for me or what, but every time we've had we'll interview people and we're like, I don't like her. And then like right in the last minute, somebody will squeeze in there and we'll be like, we love her. So it's always worked out like that. Now, I shouldn't say always. We have hired two people. We hired one front desk person and we hired one assistant, and we both let them go within 2 weeks. We just knew it immediately when they started working that, they just weren't a good fit for us.
All right. So did everybody hear that? Because here's what happens is that most people bring someone on, and then that first 2 weeks, it's like, well, maybe they'll get better. But you felt it right away.
Yeah, we felt it right away. I'll tell you, I had an assistant, and she had like 2 years experience, and she wasn't too sharp, I guess. It would be a nice way of saying it, but she was doing sterile with no gloves on. And everyone's just like, I feel like I'm telling her the same thing over and over again. I feel like this isn't working. And then we had this patient come in, and the hygienist was talking, and she's like, yeah, my daughter's actually a dental assistant. And we're like, oh, wow, where does she work? And she worked close. We're like, wow, maybe you could have her send a resume. Maybe she'd want to work here. So she sent her resume. I talked to her on the phone. She came in the next day. And I loved her. And then I said, you know what? I'm going to give this one girl one more chance. We're going to try to do one more filling appointment. And when she handed me the flowable, like the tip must not have been screwed on all the way. And when I went to go inject in the tooth, like the whole tip fell off and the flowable just went all over in the mouth. And I was like, okay.
Oh my gosh.
And then I just wrapped up that appointment. And then I went into my office manager and said, okay, it's time to fire her. And then she did.
And the manager was probably like, thank God it took you long enough to figure that out.
And you know what's weird? That was the first person I ever had to fire. And I made my office manager do it. And I watched her walk into my office manager's office. And then I said, you get in there. Just get in there and do it. Be a man. And then I walked in there and I just said, hey, you know what? This is not working out. I wish you the best. You know, I paid her for another month too, because I just felt awful about it.
But. Oh, wow. That's super nice of you. So did you cry?
Did she cry or did I cry?
Both. Did you? Both.
No, I didn't cry. But I texted my office manager after she left. I said, gosh, that was kind of fun. I feel good. Let's fire more people or something. I felt empowered. Let me add one more story about this person. So she comes in. She comes in about 8 months after I let her go as a patient. And she sits there and I go in there and I go, hi, and say her name. And she goes, hey, you know, I don't know if you remember me. Like, I worked here like 8 months ago. Like, this is like the cognition of this person. Like, the thinking I
would not. Oh, gosh.
Like, that I go, it's been 8 months and I just completely forgot. I'm like, oh, who are you? Like, what are you talking? Like, really? I mean, so she was not a good fit for us.
But you should have looked at her and said, did it work out? Like, how was it?
You know? Well, you know what's crazy is that she ended up getting a job where she replaced the assistant that replaced her just by some weird just magic. I don't know how the heck that happened.
Oh, so that office got the bad end of the swap.
Yeah.
Pretty much.
Yeah, we did an assistant swap.
That's funny. So yeah, it is. I'm hearing it all over that it's hard to find good office staff, especially assistants. Assistants seem to be the biggest pain point right now.
Right.
And, you know, to add another thing into it, you're a very successful solo practitioner. I mean, you have associates, but you're not corporate.
No,
you know?
Not at all.
Am I right? You're not corporate.
No, not
okay.
With it.
So here is what I'm hearing in areas is when a big corporation moves in, or even a multi-location that's starting to get their chopper, you know, get their choppers, and they're becoming a bigger group. They are hiring talent away from practices. Mm-hmm. And is that happening in your neck of the woods?
I don't know. I don't know if people are going to there. I mean, we do have a Heartland office. We have an Aspen near us. So it's like we have those, but I'm not really sure. You know, I just know that I'm doing okay. Now, what's been very helpful for me, as you can imagine, is that all the hires I've done has been because of growth. So mm-hmm. I'm hiring a growing practice, and I'm hiring people into like an already existing culture of great team people. So they come into this where people have been working for a long time, and we can train them in what we do, and everyone kind of knows what we do. Now, if I had turnover and I was going through people after person after person, I'd probably feel that a lot more. But I mean, we always hire for just the personality. I mean, we like to have a little bit of dental experience because we're just a very busy practice, and it's hard for us to train from the bottom up. But mm-hmm. most assistants that I've seen, I don't care if they have 10 years experience, 15, 20 years experience, or 2 years experience, they are all about at the same skill level in my eyes when they get to me. Because all I want to know when you're an assistant, when you come in, is that you know how to just maybe like retract and suction. And that's all you need to know how to do when you start. Now, I'm going to show you more things than you've ever been shown in your entire career. And you're not going to be able, you will not believe the things that you're going to learn working with me. But as long as that's, I feel like, is the hardest thing that just takes time to learn, is just where can I put my suction to stay out of your way? All the other stuff, I can train for that. I got that. And we're going to do that.
So are you adjusting your expectations then when they bring them in? And let me explain what I mean by that, because you're very technologically savvy mm-hmm. with what you do. And so that means you've had to become very super efficient. So I'm assuming that you're utilizing the assistant for procedures when you're not in the
Absolutely.
Room, you know, making the crown, making the yep. temps and all of that. So what's your learning curve then? Because they're not going to come in knowing how to do good temps if you're training them. So what's your learning curve? What's your expectation?
Right. So a lot of the stuff that I'm going to have to train. So my expectation is that they're not going to know anything. And I get that, you know, and my mm-hmm. two best assistants, and I'm going to say best assistants because they're the two that I work with the most. And the one I've been working with since I graduated, she was my very first assistant. So we're together for 10 years. And my other one, we've been together for over 7 years now. And so, I mean, they're my best assistants. And we've done so much training, like relines and adjusting crowns. They get the crowns ready. It's just, there's so many things that they can do that they're allowed to by law. And then there's some things that maybe they're not allowed to, but we can do those as well, but we just don't tell anybody about it, you know? And so mm-hmm. I want to show them how to do it. I want them to understand it. I want them to understand, like, I have an assistant training list that we go through. I want them to understand, like, the principles of light intensity, so they can understand that when that carrying light is not as close as possible, like, it's not like if it gets half as far away, you lose half the power. No, you lose, like, eight times the power. It's not a linear relationship. I want them to understand that. I want them to understand what a food trap is and why, when we create contacts on CEREC the way we do, we can create a food trap if we do it incorrectly. It's just, there's a lot to learn, but they love learning it. They want to do more than just suction. I mean, they want to be a contributing member. They want to feel good about the care we provide. And I can tell you that when we do something great for a patient, it's not, I did the procedure and she helped me with it. It's me and her, we did it together as a team. And it's not, and I just love working with my two main assistants because it's, I don't have to say anything. They know what I like. They think for me. It's like we're dancing. Now, I have other assistants and I don't work with them as much. I train them as much as I can when I work with them, but they're with my associate's assistants and they're going to train as much as my associate's willing to put into it. But I do put I do put a lot into it as well, but I mean, not as much as I do with the people that I'm with, you know, every day I'm there.
Now, I know four-handed dentistry using an assistant is not it's not taught as much as it used to mm-hmm. be in school, in dental schools, which is such a damn shame because it's so beautiful to watch when it's done well.
Yeah.
Were you taught that and are you teaching that?
I don't know if I was taught it. No, I definitely wasn't taught it. I think my original assistant, maybe she was taught it where she was at. I don't know. It's always been going at it with the mentality that if there's any point in any procedure that I'm not doing anything, let's mm-hmm. figure out something for me to do. And I'll give this example. This happened when I was working with my associate's assistant while she was on maternity leave, is that I would go ahead, I put the bond on and she would hand me the air water syringe to thin my bond. Okay. I would thin my bond with air water and then she would hold her hand out because she wanted me to hand it back to her. So then I hand it back to her. She hangs it up, puts the curing light on the tooth. And I say, well, why don't I just hang it up? And when I get done drying it, you're already curing. That'll save us. Yeah, I mean, it saves us 4 seconds, but it's just going at it with the mentality like that. Like, if I'm not doing everything in at every moment and you're not doing something at every moment, we're going to figure out something to do. Like,
Absolutely.
Yeah, when we take off like a matrix band and my assistant will cure from the buckle and the lingual, and I'll grab my handpiece, I load up my polishing burr, I grab my slow speed, I load up my enhanced polisher, I put that on. I wish you could almost see us do an obturation for a root canal, because there's no words, but we have a system. We have an order of canals depending on what tooth it is. And these are things that we just went over with, and we've created these systems. Some of them we have documents for. And this is how we do it. And we do it like this every time. And it's seamless and it goes very fast and allows us to be super efficient.
That is a product that would sell like hotcakes if you could record yourselves doing that, because there's not a lot of videos of four-handed dentistry. And when I talk to team members and they're younger, they really don't understand what I'm talking about. Now, I'll show them some videos, but, you know, I really do think it's a dying art. And it's just, you know, the pinky finger is powerful when it comes to assisting. And this is coming from somebody who was a bad assistant. I mean, I was okay, but I was much better up front. But you remind me a lot of my doctor, because he took the time to explain procedures, and he would do it in patient-friendly words, which was great. And then later on, we always had, it was a small office, we always had lunch together at the bar across the street.
Yeah.
And then that's when he would explain, you know, more of the intricacies. But had he not done that, I would not have understood, again, why it's important with the curing light and why. Right. Well, back then, that was when I was doing the amalgam, the trick. The wiggle bugs, you know. And again, young people, don't worry about it. You'll never see one unless it's in a dental museum. So it's okay.
Well, they have those cements that need those too. So we still use those.
Oh, that's true. That's true. Yeah. Well, and another thing too is, you know, one of the things you learn quickly is you wipe off instruments as soon as they get into your hand, so they're ready for the next usage. And and it is really just a beautiful thing. So if you are doing that with your assistance on a regular basis, Paul, that's, to me, that's a video series I would pay for sure.
Yeah, I've thought about it too. And like, and if you had me show you what my assistant does, I have no idea. I just know she's like an octopus with like 8 hands, and she's got like something wrapped around each of her fingers in her left hand. And you know, she puts the suction between her knees, and it's just, I mean, they're awesome.
This is what you do. Paul, you just record it, and then the two, like a movie commentary, record it and then go back and do a commentary over it.
That might be my next project.
Oh my God, you've got to do this.
I'm wrapping up a video project right now, and I'm like, what's next? What are we going to do next? And I'm like, I'm just going to chill out for a little bit and just hang out by the pool for a few months, but I'll get bored. I'll have to take on another big project. That might be the next one.
I was going to say, that's what we all say, that we're going to chill out, and then it just moves on to the next one. So what's your project? What videos are you doing now? Tell me about that.
So me and a dentist, there's a dentist from Canada. His name is Justin Bullard, and he lives in Florida. He owns 6 practices in Canada, lives in Florida. He does 2 days clinical a month. And we just got together. We were friends through meeting at seminars and stuff like that, and started talking. He started talking about his projects. He wanted to do a video practice management thing. I wanted to do one too. So we teamed up, and it was actually a really good pairing, because you got two really good perspectives, like him being almost like an absentee owner and mine being having just a great culture and leadership and team and stuff like that. And just a really high performing single practice, very large practice, but single practice. And we just made, we haven't counted yet because we're still getting them edited, but I think we're like 150, 160 videos, just all encompassing everything from phone skills to marketing to collections to presenting treatment. How we schedule, how do we get more efficient clinically? It's mostly business related. There's not a lot of clinical stuff, but there's a lot of things about clinical efficiency, kind of the things that we just previously talked about. And we're just putting it all on a website with a workbook and I'm sharing all of the documents I've created in my practice. He's sharing all the documents that he has in his practice. And we're just trying to create like just a one-stop shop for just dental business training. So it's
phenomenal.
Yeah. Hoping that's going to launch. We're hoping like the end of August, but you know how things go, but I'm really hoping for the end of August, because we're almost pretty much done with all of the content. It's just getting it edited, getting it all looking the same, and organizing it.
Will you send me a link so that I can, I'm sure you have a link for updates and subscriptions.
I'll send you a link. It's dentalbusinessmentor.com. So we have a landing page right now. It's a preliminary landing page, and you can sign up for, if you want to get email when it's all ready, we'll send it out. But it's just, it's still in its infancy, and I'm hoping by the end of August, but we've been rolling on it. It's been like my nonstop thing for the past like 3 weeks. I haven't stopped doing anything other than that.
Wow. Wow. And it's funny. You asked me, are we getting on video this morning? No wonder you asked, because you're just like, you've been on video this whole time. Like, enough. Right. Oh my goodness. So I was cracking up because one of the questions that you asked me when I was a guest on your podcast is to explain a clinical procedure, you know, the way that I would to, you know, a layperson. You know, what's my best tip? And I'm not going to tell my listeners what that is, because I want them to listen to that episode on your podcast. But you, so I wanted to turn it around on you and ask if there's anything lately that you found yourself saying that you're like, hey, I should record that, or, you know, hey, that was a pretty good analogy. Anything cool lately?
You know, yeah, nothing lately that's new, but I think one of the things that I like to say that this is my own, and I like it because I didn't hear it from anyone else. I came up with that on my own, is that when the patient comes in with the crown that's broken off, and they say, why can't you just cement it back on? And, you know, and I say, you know, a crown is like a helmet. It goes over the head. Now, if the helmet comes off, we can put that helmet back on. But the problem is that the head broke off inside the helmet. So there's nothing to put back on.
Oh, my God. What a visual. You need a Lego. Yeah. You need a Lego piece to illustrate that, like that.
Or just hold the dandelion and flip the top off, you know, like you see the kids just in the head.
Oh my gosh, that's hilarious. No, and it's funny because we do come up with all these crazy analogies because patients really don't understand what the heck we're talking about. So, and so have you ever heard like one of your team members try to do something and you're like, eh, that didn't really work? Have you ever heard anything like that?
Oh gosh, I heard my associate say, someone asked her, what was a crown? And she goes, what we do is we cut off the top of the tooth and we cut off about a millimeter and a half from each of the sides and we make room so we can cover it in porcelain. Oh. And I'm just like, I want to talk about cutting teeth.
Yeah. That's like, you might as well bring out a chainsaw while you're talking about it.
Yeah. We changed that. You know, he's like, you know, Chris Bowman. Have you met Chris Bowman?
Yeah.
So he always talks about termites, like cavities are termites in the tooth. But he says you can't say termites without holding your hands up and wiggling your fingers like jazz hands. You go, termites. And your fingers are going, these termites in your teeth.
You just made me do it. I just jazz handed. So
I was doing it too.
Let's switch a little bit because we were talking about teams and then we went to jazz hands. So this is all over the place. What I loved about the you talked clinical, of course, but the business part of it, you know, you talked about schedule and all that, but you kept hammering home my favorite topic, which is money. So you were saying that the practice has to have high cash flow because it has to reinvest in itself. You are able to give yourselves bonus. You've changed the way you bonus a little bit to your team.
Yeah, we did.
But you still are able to manage your employee cost to, what do you have it down to? Like 28%, 30%? What do you have it to?
We're about 25%.
Okay. Which is really, I mean, I hear from doctors all the time, I can't even get it under 30. Like, what's going on? Can you talk a little bit about that profit margin that is squeezable? Because I've been saying it, and I think sometimes it's nice when somebody else says it. So tell me about the squeezable profit margin that the dental industry seems to enjoy.
So just to clarify, you want me to talk about the payroll?
No, you were talking about the overall, like you compared us to Walmart and you compared us to like a tire show.
That's okay.
Yeah.
I mean, when you really think about it in dentistry, I mean, our supply costs are like almost nothing. And our fixed costs are almost nothing. And I know a lot of people said fixed costs are almost nothing. You're out of your mind. Now let me talk a little bit longer. I think it's not that it's not difficult, but I feel like it's easy to keep your overhead under control. But what we'll often, like dentists will get stuck doing is they get stuck in this penny pinching mentality. Like I got to reduce expenses. When the problem is not really an expense problem, it's a revenue problem, is that we're not doing the work efficient enough. We're not doing it fast enough. We're not seeing enough people. And I'm not advocating like just, you know, herding them in like cattle and running them through. I'm just saying, let's get efficient about what we're doing so that we can, you know, start enjoying that larger profit margin. When you start getting up there in production and you start getting really intentional about the way you schedule and the efficiencies of the delivery of the care, That's when you start seeing all those categories get a little bit under control. And then if you want to do like the, I'm going to kind of get my supplies a little bit lower, or I'm going to get this a little bit lower. It's not as big of a deal, but you still want to do it. So I've never been a big person on reducing expenses. Mm-hmm. I've always been more about outproducing the expenses I have. So I'll say like when we have my payroll, I'm very transparent with the staff and I'll say, hey, you know, we're going to keep this at 25-28%. And that's where I want it. And we will do a bonus based on if we get above that production number, that keeps it at that number. And we always bonus. Mm-hmm. So it's a profit share. It always keeps my stuff in line. It's performance based. We're producing at a level of that. And I can tell you, like me, myself. So when my associate was gone, and this is not everybody, I don't expect everybody to do this, but when my associate was gone on a maternity, I was producing at a level $16.50 an hour.
Wow.
Now my associate's up there about $9.50 an hour. And then my other associate, she's a year and a half out of school and she's doing almost $700 an hour. So these are not unobtainable numbers. Right. And I guarantee you that none of these, my associates feel like they're running like crazy. It's just the way we schedule. And it's the way that we deliver the care that allows us to do it in that manner.
It's really, if you're making more money, that 25% stays the same, but the 25% total is bigger. And that's mm-hmm. really what you can pay out to your team. What I hear a lot with doctors is they, exactly what you said, they try to squeeze supplies and the supplier reps complain about this because they even know like what the problem is. So you try to squeeze your expenses and then you raise your fees. So those two things are just Band-Aids. I mean, the mm-hmm. real problem is, like you said, the efficiency and then the staff retention, because turnover is a killer. It's just an absolute killer. Now, so one, and I'll just to illustrate how much, you know, wiggle room we have. I remember I go to a lot of insurance meetings, and one of the dental consultants next to me, the ones who review your claims, he said to me, these dentists, I guess he didn't realize I was not a dental consultant. And he said, these dentists, man, they got the best profit margins in any industry. So they complain about us shaving 5 or 6% off their reimbursements. They're rolling it in anyways. And I was like, wow. Yeah. And the more I thought about it though, he's kind of got a point. You know, I mean, restaurants have a tiny, tiny, tiny profit margin. Overall, mm-hmm. we have double digit profit margins. I think a lot of industry would love to have our profit margins.
Well, yeah, I mean, you talk about like Mark Costas, he talks about when he owned a pizza place. He's like, do you know how many pizzas you have to sell to have the profit of 1 crown? Like, that's a lot of pizzas.
Wow. Yeah. Yeah. It's something to think about. We have it good. We really do. Our industry, I think, which is kind of scary because it seems like we're starting to go down the medical path. You know, what do you think will happen if reimbursement turns into a medical model? Like, what if it goes to single payer? What do you think is going to happen there?
I have no idea. I don't even want to think about it. It's kind of scary when you think about it. I hope it doesn't ever go the same way as medical.
Yeah.
You know, I mean, we've always said, and I've heard people say, gosh, I wish this medical insurance would just pick up dental and then we wouldn't have to deal with the crappy dental insurance. I mean, no, you don't. I mean, we don't want.
No.
Trust me. We do not want this covered under medical. It would be a nightmare.
Mm-hmm.
I think it's hard for the people, and I think it's going to be hard for the people, the in-betweeners. You know, it's going to be the corporations are going to survive because they've got the scale, the size, and the practices like mine that are really focusing on providing a great patient experience and going above and beyond. We're going to do okay. And I think everybody in the middle is going to have a really hard time.
Yeah, I agree with you on that. Does this make you think a little bit more about a concierge model? I mean, you're already kind of doing it, but does it make you think a little bit more about exploring that?
Well, yeah. I mean, you mean concierge like going fee for service?
Yeah.
Like just,
yeah. If this happens, if it shakes out.
Well, that would be our next thing. Once we get to capacity again, we are 5 ops and we were at capacity and that was our next step, but we decided to expand to 11 ops. So right now we're still in growth mode, but once we get there, that'll be the next thing. And we're not on a lot of plans either. I mean, we're on a few third party like umbrella plans that take little pieces of each one, but we are definitely not on everything. And our fee schedules are pretty decent. We only see about maybe like a 15 to 20% write off on most of ours. So that helps a lot too.
Okay. So talk to me a little bit about Watch Adonis. And now, were you a Watch Adonis? How did you get away from being a Watch Adonis?
So for me, yes, I occasionally am a Watch Adonis. I mean, a Watch Adonis is anyone who just wants, is doesn't feel comfortable talking to the patient about what they really see. And what I hate about this creates a situation where we might get a new patient that comes in and we see these things, but we feel like we have to gain their trust. We can't tell them everything that we see right away, because then they're just going to run from us and think we're over treatment planning. But I mean, I always tell people, think about if you went somewhere that you don't really like to go in the first place, and every time you go there, they tell you need another crown. So someone turns into, it's like the crown of the year club. Like, oh, like, yep, you broke another one. Now we need another crown. It's like, gosh, every time I go there, they want to put another crown on my teeth. I always just suggest, you know, you always just got to tell the patient what it is, tell them what you see. It helps when you can show them intraorals. And I always tell people, I say, hey, you know, this doesn't make me right and your previous dentist wrong. I don't know this was even existing last time you saw them. It's just, this is the way that I treat and plan. This is how I would want, this is what I would do in my own mouth. And this is what I think you should do for yours. Now, having said that, I always like to ask the patients if they want to be more proactive or reactive, or I'll ask them what their goals are for their mouth. And if somebody's more reactive and they say, I just want to fix things when they break and they hurt, well, that's okay with me. I don't want to give it to them. I don't want to bring them down slowly and give them little by little. I want to tell them what I see all at once.
So instead of, because I know the big thing is to phase the treatment plan, and you probably still do that, but you are a big fan of giving them the total in the beginning and then breaking it down into chunks. Is that what I'm hearing?
Yeah. We definitely do give them the total. We don't give them little pieces. I mean, we break it down into pieces, so little bite-sized chunks that are more palatable, I suppose. But we are not going to hold back. We are going to comprehensively care plan them. And I will tell them, this may seem like a lot, but this is the bare minimum amount of dentistry you will need for the rest of your life. This is the bare minimum. You're going to need this at some point. You know, the new things are going to pop up, but this is the bare minimum. At some point, we're going to do this.
Now, if you were a dentist, have you ever actually, you are a dentist, obviously, but have you ever been in the chair and somebody said to you that you needed any dental work? Did that make you greatly upset? Like, how does it feel when a dentist gets told they need work?
Yeah. So I had literally 6 cavities last time I got looked at. And so when I had ortho, I was slightly class 3 and I was edge to edge occlusion. And what my orthodontist had done is we did a lot of interproximal reduction on my lower incisors, like a lot, like to where there was like almost like no enamel left. And pretty much every one of those spots got decay in them because of the enamel was missing. So then when they told me, I'm like, what the hell are you talking about? I got a kid. I'm like, turning around, like, let me see that x-ray. You're crazy. And, lo and behold, there they are. So yeah, it didn't feel good for me. I can't imagine it feels good for anyone else. And, you know, and sometimes, you know, I do things that are stupid as well. Like I had one tooth that hurt when I bit on it and I waited and I put it off until eventually I needed a root canal, and I had the root canal and a crown now on it. And it's, and I'm pretty sure within 2 or 3 years, I'll probably lose that tooth because I put it off for so long. But if it was a virgin tooth, I'm a big clencher and I wear my neck guard, but I don't always wear my neck guard. And, yeah, I just broke it clenching.
I apologize for the kind of the off ramp we just took, but I've always wondered, like, what does it feel for a dentist to be told?
I feel like a failure. I go home where they can't hurt me.
I still do insurance claims for an office and a couple offices, actually small things. And when I get a claim back that I run my report and I'm like, oh, this claim got away from me. I'm like, oh, I teach this. Like this shouldn't happen to me. So I understand that abject failure feeling that you
human.
Got.
We're all human and we're all capable of, you know, we're all the same.
So what would you take on an island, like a tropical island with you? If you were stranded on an island, would it be floss or a toothbrush?
It would definitely be a toothbrush. Well, see, let me change that, because I probably couldn't. It'd be probably hard to find a floss substitute on an island. And I feel like I could find a floss or a toothbrush substitute, like I'd use a t-shirt or something like that. So maybe I'd bring the floss.
Or just sand. I mean,
yeah.
Couldn't you just use the sand? Like, I can imagine the only thing close to that would be like a coconut husk.
Yeah.
Like, and that just doesn't sound right to me. So, because you don't know where that coconut's been. Let's just be honest about that, right?
Well, then the other thing, too, is if I'm the only one on the island, do I even care about hygiene at all?
Oh, that's a good point. See, now that's a guy thing. That's a guy thing. That is the big difference between a guy answer and a girl answer. Because a girl answer would be like, oh my God, my hair is going to get so oily. What's going to happen here? You know? Let's be honest. That's a daily thing for a lot of guys, right? Like, let's just see how bad we can get this, right?
That's too funny.
Oh, yeah. Goodness. So let's go ahead and start wrapping this up. I always ask people, what are you guys watching? Like, what are you seeing, anything on Prime or Netflix or Hulu that's really getting to you?
You know, right now I'm not watching anything, but and I'm thankful I'm not watching anything because I get on these Netflix shows and I just can't stop them and I don't sleep and I watch them all. We watched one called The OA on Netflix. Oh. Have you seen that?
That's like a sci-fi thing. My husband has watched that. Is it any
very,
good?
Wow. It's mind-blowing, but you can't miss a single episode. You need to watch it all because there's different dimensions and it gets a little hard to keep track of, but a lot of it's about like near-death experiences and where we go when we die and when we come back and dimensional travel. And it's just a big mind-blowing. There's only two seasons of it, but it was really cool. I liked it a lot.
Is that your jam, the sci-fi?
You know, not really. It's really not my jam, but I was Googling things to watch on Netflix and people said good things about it and we gave it a try. And I think any of these shows, if you start watching them, it doesn't matter what it is. They're created by people that know how to create things that are entertaining. So it's all good.
Well, if you want to binge, I talked about this on my last episode. Mm-hmm. Dark is the one that really just, it sucked me in and it frustrated me at the same time.
So it's
a time travel type thing. Uh-huh. And it is, it's very sci-fi and there's a murder mystery involved in there too, or a kidnapping mystery. And I needed a guide because there were so many characters and they were aged. So like, oh my God, I needed a chart. It's like watching Game of Thrones. So it was really good, but it was kind of like that. Like it just kind of sucked you into it and you just didn't see things coming. And, but I do prefer like lighthearted stuff or full horror. Like that's really my two things. But this one I took a chance on because everybody was saying it's so good. And sure enough, you know, and I texted the person who turned me onto it. And I was just like, you know what? I curse you because this made me, I felt like I was back in grad school, like studying for a final, you know? So, but anyways.
Well, I got to check that out. This sounds like a good one. I like the ones that are complicated. I liked how complicated Game of Thrones was. And me and my wife will watch it. She'd be like, who is this? I'm like, oh my gosh, do you not watch? Do you not pay attention?
Totally. That's me. I get it. Yeah. Hi, listeners. Sorry about this, but Paul's audio dropped off, and so we're going to say goodbye to him now. I will put links to his podcast and to his book. I'll have all of that in the show notes, and I'm really excited for when the video series comes out, so I'll make sure to add in information about that so you can be informed of it as well. I also wanted to let you know about an event that I just found out about, which is Weave's Practice Growth Summit. It's all online, and there's some CE attached as well. Go ahead and go to trygetweave.com. Weave Practice Growth Summit. I'll put the link in the show notes. Go ahead and register for it, and then you'll have access to a ton of videos. I just checked it out, and I love the fact that I'm going to be able to listen to them at my leisure because life is busy, and we have patients coming at us, and I have kids coming at me, and I have a dog coming at me, and I have calls and all that kind of stuff, and I know you are the same way with your patients and your family. So check out Weave's Practice Growth Summit. Check out Paul's links to his podcast and to his book, which I do love his book. I read it and really enjoyed it. And then I will talk to you on the next episode. Thank you.
Subscribe to this podcast so you'll get our next candid discussion. Visit Teresa's website, odysseymgmt.com. That's odysseymgmt.com for more information on Teresa's courses, books, and speaking schedule. Subscribe to her newsletter while you're there. Don't say we didn't tell you that.